Hello, this is my sustainability exhibition center that I designed as part of the CE220B class, and I will walk you through my ideas which are reflected in the design of the building and its systems. First of all, let me give you a brief background on the project description. The objective of this project was to design an elegant and functional building that exemplifies sustainable building practices and provides a focal point for green building enthusiasts in the Bay Area. The building features exhibition space and resources for visitors to explore various possibilities and features in the green building world that can be used and replicated in other buildings. I used this project as a point of integration for the many systems that we covered in our class, so my initial design evolved and changed as the class progressed. We were provided with a Revit project file preloaded with the terrain and location set to Jasper Ridge, adjacent to Stanford campus. The total floor area budget was set to around 12 to 15,000 square feet. This is the outline I will follow. I will start with my architectural model, discuss the results I got from the multiple analysis I did, move to the structural and NDP model, and at the end, I will talk about the sustainable house I designed nearby. I came up with the idea of a floor plan with 9 squares with a courtyard in the center. I feel that this shape gives me a lot of freedom in assigning spaces and encourages human interaction. All sides of my building are narrow with a width of 30 to 40 feet in order to maximize daylight and natural ventilation. The whole building will be ventilated naturally. Since this building will include both public spaces like the exhibition center and private spaces such as offices for the employees, I spent some time thinking how to separate the public from the private spaces. I know that it is common strategy in these occasions to put all the public spaces in the first floor and all the private ones in the second, but I wanted to try something different, so I put all the offices and the private rooms in the north. And you can see with the dotted line where the private offices are. Having offices in the north maximizes indirect sunlight, but not direct, which would increase heat and discomfort in a working place. On the other hand, the public spaces in the south will enjoy beautiful views of the local wildlife. My strategy also includes putting areas which are less occupied in east and west, where it is harder to control the sun. So this is the floor plan of my first floor. When you enter the building from here, there is a guest lobby and welcoming area. Right next to it, for marketing purposes, I put the gift shop featuring books and educational materials on sustainability. On the east, I also have the restrooms and the storage room. On the west side, I put the MEP system because it is hard to control the sun there. Next to it is an interactive kid-focused play zone where the kids can experience sustainable technologies firsthand, right next to the cafeteria, so that parents can enjoy a coffee while their kids are playing. I also surrounded the visitor cafe with a patio where guests can enjoy their coffee outdoors in a beautiful view. On the second floor, there is a clear distinction between public spaces on the south and private ones on the north, each of them with a separate stairway. Public spaces include 2 exhibition areas for permanent and temporary exhibits on sustainable design principles and technologies, and 2 educational spaces and seminar rooms. The private rooms include offices, the office of the center director, administrative staff and volunteers, and a large conference room. I will do a walkthrough of my building in glue at the end, and you will get a better understanding of the layout of my building. I'm also providing ADA compliant restrooms on each level. The total area of my building is almost 13,900 square feet, which is in the asked range. After I designed the floor plans, I looked at the accessibility and egress, and I realized that all my exits were in the south side. That means that in case of a fire in the south side, I was not providing alternative exits to the occupants. As a result, I went back and created exits in the north part, both on the first and on the second floor. Lesson learned, when I design floor plans, I will always keep egress in mind. And the same is for the second floor. This is a snapshot of all the sustainability features in my building. To begin with, I already mentioned the small width in order to maximize daylighting and natural ventilation. I also put a thermal mass in the form of concrete floors in order to reduce temperature fluctuation and to reduce heating loads. Trump wall on southwest side for this reason, and I will get into more detail for this in the next slide. Very high insulation for both the walls and the roofs, so as to provide more uniform temperatures throughout the space. The roofs are sloped, facing the south, so as to maximize the output of the solar panels. I have also put wind turbines, both for educational purposes and to maximize the electricity that I can actually generate on campus. On the offices facing south, I used light cells, which reflect daylight onto the ceiling and deeper into the space. Green roofs for thermal resistance and visual appealing and to improve air quality. Access to the roof for occupants. I performed a lighting analysis and two rooms turned out to be darker than they should, so I added skylights in this room. I'm collecting all the rainwater and storing it in a rainwater tank, which is actually important in California right now because of the severe drought. All the windows are triple glazing low-E windows, even at the curtain walls. Operable windows for ventilation and to increase occupants control. Finally, I have already mentioned about the large openings on the south and north side, where it is easy to control the sun compared to the negligible window to wall ratio on east and west. A big focus of my building is to control sunlight and heat gains. As you can see in the top left picture, I have strong walls on south west side, and at the bottom, then actually this picture at the bottom summarizes my strategy. In the morning, the sun is on southeast side, and I actually needed to heat my building, so I put curtain walls on this side. However, in the evening, when the sun is on southwest, my building is already heated and I do not want to heat it anymore, so I put a strong wall on this side in order to absorb and store heat energy during the day and re-radiate it at night. This way, I do not need to preheat my building early in the morning. The idea of the strong wall gives this zigzag shape to my building. To be honest, the first time I heard the concept of the Trump wall, I realized that it would be useful, but I was worried that it will probably not look nice in the building. This is why I did these renderings of the rooms of two rooms with Trump walls, and they actually look quite beautiful. My effort to control sun with overhangs is shown in these two pictures. At noon, at winter solstice, I need the sun to heat my building and drive my cooling loads down. This is why I allow most of it to enter the building and provide passive solar heating. However, at noon, at summer solstice, I do not need heat anymore, so I prevent sun from entering the building in order to reduce the cooling needs. And you can see that both the front and the back side of my building are shaded. I mentioned about the skylights. Here you can see that this seminar room was quite dark early in the morning, but the skylights bring the necessary daylight inside the room. Here's another thing that I tried. I wanted a beautiful courtyard as a focal point in the center of my building, and large openings and curtain walls facing the courtyard to provide beautiful views from inside the rooms, but at the same time, I had to provide privacy for people working in these rooms. So I spent some time trying to find the balance. This is why I put this series of light cells on the conference room on the first floor. I had a total curtain wall on the second floor, but I realized that a person from the courtyard could actually sit directly inside the director's office. This is why I changed the curtain wall, which now starts from an elevation of 4 feet. And this is the conference room of the first floor, and you can see that it creates this sense of privacy, although it is right next to the courtyard. These are the rooms on the second floor facing the courtyard, the director's office, and the small conference room. You can see that the occupants from this room can enjoy beautiful views of the courtyard, and the director can control the building without losing from his privacy. I try to bring an outdoor scene because I think this is something people love and increases their productivity. This is why I put many plants indoors, a dominant courtyard at the center, and a green roof accessible to the public in which visitors can hang out. No matter where you are in the building, you can get outdoors in less than 25 feet. I wanted to make green roofs easily accessible both from the interior and the exterior of my building. I also did not want to design one more museum where people would go once or maximum twice a year. I want them to love the place and want to come back. This is why I created a stairway that takes visitors on the roof where they can hang out and enjoy their time. As you can see, there is an interesting connection between indoors and outdoors. I tried to design a healthy building, but at the same time, I also wanted to encourage healthy lifestyles. On the top right picture, you can see bike lockers on the back door to encourage employees' bike to work. On the bottom left, I saw that I used a dominant stairway right next to the main entrance to encourage people to use the stairs instead of the elevator, which is hidden at the back. It is better both for their health and the environment, as they burn calories instead of electricity. I have mentioned multiple times that I emphasize a lot on natural daylighting. Apart from the iridescent, I also came up with more ideas. For example, daylight windows in the office and the main interior walls in the form of clear story and glass doors. Also, curtain walls in interior walls maximize daylighting penetration and visual comfort. And sometimes this is also used for functionality. For example, parents are able to watch their kids while their kids are in the kids area because there's a curtain wall between the two spaces. Interior design was done in order to maximize daylighting contribution. I used low desk separations to ensure that daylighting penetrates to all aspects of the building, and white walls in offices which will reflect the light incident on them, creating a brighter room. As you can see in the picture, the office is bright without the need of artificial lighting. For lighting, I'm using indirect lighting with LED task lighting. I also have ceiling fans, which I will explain later. So one of my goals was to make my building net zero energy. I performed an energy analysis, and it turns out that the system with rooftop PVs and wind turbines helps me generate more electricity on site than I'm actually consuming. As far as the lighting analysis is concerned, I passed both LED 2009 and LED V4 tests. Let me move to the structural analysis. I chose this steel structure with concrete floors in order to provide thermal mass too. You can see here the structural elements I used. I would like to draw your attention to the fact that I used shear walls in east and west direction and two other shear walls in the interior of the other direction, so as to be able to capture all potential earthquake loads. Structural braces are placed on the north side. All columns end 2 to 3 feet below ground. The building has several shafts for elevators and stairways, so sometimes columns had to be complemented with structural walls to properly distribute loads to the ground. Moreover, beam systems had to be adjusted in stairway shaft. I applied area loads in the floors and line loads in the main beams of the roof. So I placed the walls in the structural model, and then I went back to the architectural model and I realized that part of them were exposed, which made it look ugly. When the column was next to a wall, as shown in the left picture, I used interior walls to surround it so that it will not be visible to the users. Whenever I had to place a column at the center of a space and I could not hide it putting walls, I used an architectural column to surround it, which is on the picture on the right, so it looks better to the user. Finally, I ran a structural analysis. It turned out that some of the elements had a ratio higher than 1, so they had to change. I analyzed these groups of elements and optimized the sections by weight in order to come up with a structure that could carry all the loads. It was overall an easy process, and the optimization tool made my life very easy, as otherwise I would have to try different elements in order to find the most appropriate ones. I started a new mechanical template for my mechanical model. I'm a big fan of radiant floors cut with ceiling fans, so I used the radiant floor system to provide heating and cooling. In the summer, the airflow produced by the ceiling fans creates a wind chill effect, making you feel cooler. In the winter, the fan produces a gentle updraft, which forces warm air near the ceiling, down into the occupied space. I created the radiant floor system for each zone in each floor. The supply and return pipes for each zone go to the MEP room in the first floor, where the manifolds are placed to control heating and cooling for each zone. Overall, I realized the complexity of designing the MEP systems and how many things have to be taken into consideration. This complexity is pictured in the 3D model of the MEP systems. The air source heat pump, second image, is placed on the right outside the MEP room in an open space at the end of the cafeteria patio. In this way, visitors will be able to see it and understand how heating and cooling in the building works. For the same reason, the rainwater tank is close to it. In my architectural design, I focused on creating a shape that will maximize natural ventilation. Moreover, most rooms are equipped with ceiling fans to circulate air. As a result, I will be able to meet the ventilation needs for most days of the year. However, there will be few days in which I will not be able to meet them with night flashing and ceiling fans, so I am adding heat recovery ventilators, HRVs, which will operate these days. HRVs transfer some of the heat and moisture between the incoming and the outgoing air, making them much more energy efficient. I added 3 HRVs in the first floor and 2 HRVs on the second floor. 2 HRVs are placed in the MEP room and the others are above the ceiling in the zones they cover. I calculated the ventilation needs, and here you can see the spreadsheet with the calculations. ERSRI has published the required CFM per person and per square foot. I calculated the total ventilation needs, taking into account the area and the occupancy of each room. I used the size the duct tool to size the ducts in order to provide that amount of ventilation. The heating temperature is said to be 70 degrees Fahrenheit in all the rooms, apart from the welcome lobby zone, in which it is set to 68. The cooling temperature varies from 72 to 76 depending on the use of each room. As far as the restrooms and the food preparation rooms are concerned, I used exhaust fans and exhaust air ducts in these rooms only, because I did not want to put the air from these rooms onto my main ventilation system, being worried that this will bring smells from these rooms to other rooms. I'm using grey water collection from the sinks to flush toilets and urinals. I also have one pipe coming from the municipal water supply. Part of it goes to the water heater in order to provide the building with hot water. Sprinklers are placed at each floor on the ceiling for the case of a fire. The distance between neighboring sprinklers is according to the regulation. Overall, I designed all this and I was proud, and then I performed a class detection just to realize that things were not working that well. Here are a couple of pictures of classes found. I performed the class detection both in Revit and glue. Running it through glue, I realized that some ducts were overlapping with beams with structural elements for as much as 5 inches. I tried to correct these classes on a one-on-one basis, but I realized that there was not enough room for both the structural and the MEP systems in the ceiling, as the floor-to-floor height was 15 feet and the floor-to-ceiling was 12 feet. When I sized the ducts, some of them became really tall and could not fit. As a result, I decided to drop the ceiling by 6 inches to ensure that there's plenty of room for all the elements. My final floor to ceiling height is 11 feet and 6 inches. That eliminated the number of classes, and I reached a point with a total number of 0 interferences. This exercise shows that with proper planning, there is room for all the systems. I have a structural beam under the green roof, return and supply ducts, cold and water, hot and cold water pipes, a grey water pipe, and sanitary pipes. I also designed a small sustainable house project of 1,000 square feet close to my exhibition center. I used the same exterior walls with wood finish as in my exhibition center in order to create this sense of consistency between the two buildings, as they will be located nearby. The designing considerations are similar with those of the exhibition center. Large openings on the south side, pergola on the south side to block a direct sunlight from entering the building, and also create a nice area for occupants to enjoy their time outdoors. Clear story windows in the north side to create a bright area. Very low window to wall ratio on east and west sides, where it is harder to control the sun. You can see the floor plan and the 3D model. The restroom has 2 pocket doors, one at the side of the one side of the restroom can actually be used by the occupants and the other is at the side of the living room, which can be used by guests in order to ensure that they will not have to go through the bedroom to actually enter the restrooms. A mechanical room was placed in the northwest side of my building to host the mechanical equipment needed to control the electricity produced by solar panels. Designing the sustainable house, I had three goals in mind: to reach net zero energy, net zero water, and also design something that is easy to be built. I met the net zero energy goal quite easily, which is logical since there will be only two people staying in the house, which means minimal electrical consumption. At the same time, there is plenty of area in roofs for PVs. The roof is sloped facing the south in order to maximize the solar panel's output. This image on the right shows the results of the energy analysis of, and it is clear that the house meets the net zero energy target and actually produces more electricity than it consumes. In order to collect the rainfall, I placed a gutter on the side of the roof. The rainwater is then stored in the underground tank shown in the image. I calculated the average rainfall captured based on the meteorological data of the region, and I modeled the water requirements of the house. The house needs outweighed the amount of rainfall captured, but if I use a grey water system to flush the toilet, I do reach the net zero water target. Nowadays, a great emphasis is placed on shortening the construction duration and lowering its cost. For this reason, my building consists of five simple pieces which can be prefabricated to high specifications and efficiency standards and then shipped to site. In this way, my house can be built in a few days. So overall, the good part from my project and my experience and the time that I spent this quarter is that I believe that I'm used to designing architectural models and I feel pretty confident to do it. The lighting and energy analysis were very easy to use and they are tools that can provide you with feedback on how the house performs when you're experimenting with different designs. Always good to use these tools when you try different ideas. The bad part was trying to fit all the mechanical and structural systems above the ceiling. It required way more time than I thought, and it turned out that the easiest and most effective idea was to just lower the ceiling. Finally, the ugly part was the structural analysis. I faced some connectivity software issues and my model was not transferred to structural robot analysis, and it took me a while to fix it. If I had more time, I would add the Trump wall with water and electric lighting wiring and see how that adds another complexity to the system that already exists. If I had to design the building from scratch, I would place the restrooms on the second floor on top of the ones on the first floor to make my life easier when it comes to doing the plumbing systems. I would also put the MEP room at the center of the building. Thank you. I will leave you with the rendering showing the path that connects these two buildings, and I will also walk you through my exhibition center in glue. This is my Sanford Sustainability Exhibition Center at Glue. You can see that I used an exterior glass elevator. I will walk you through my model. So when you enter the building, you enter this welcome lobby. Here is the dominant stairway. And in front of us is the
gift shop which is an open space with shelves. At the center is a courtyard. You can see the clerestory windows at the top of all the walls so that the light can penetrate. These are the restrooms on my right and the storage room. At the north side, I have this office space. As you can see, many offices. At this side, close to the courtyard, I have this conference room. And here is a series of light cells in order to create some sense of privacy. If we continue walking, here is the stairway and the north exit. And on our right hand, in front of us is one seminar room. You can see it here with computers. This is the MEP room on the west side. I have many plans in interior in order to bring outdoor scene. This is the kids area. Next to the cafeteria patio, and I used an curtain wall between these two rooms so that parents can enjoy their coffee and also be able to have a good idea of what their kids are doing. Here is my cafeteria. And over there is the food preparation area. You can see the indirect lighting that I have. Compost bins in order to recycle as much compost as possible. And now we are at the outside patio. This is just outside the kids area for the kids to play. You can see here the water tank and here is the air source heat pump so that visitors can actually come here outdoors and get to see how cooling and heating in the system works. And also plenty of space for people to sit outdoors and enjoy the beautiful views of the wildlife. I will take you to the second floor. I just wanted to start with this view, which is the north side of my building. You can see the bike lockers, a ramp for the bikes, exterior stairways for which the visitors can use to access the green roofs. Green roofs have open space and sitting area where people can enjoy their time. On the north side, on the second floor, I have only private spaces. So if we enter the building, this is a conference room, smaller than the one in the first floor, which looks over the courtyard. Right opposite to it is a big office for administrative staff and volunteers. You can see also the ceiling fans. Right at the end is I have ADA compliant restrooms, and this is the other room here, and is the director's office. Here is the director's office, a place for visitors to sit, and you can see what I told you, that from because of this part of the wall, people from the courtyard cannot actually see inside. If we now go to the south part of the second floor, these are some other skylights that I have used for other rooms. The elevator, and here is the first section of the exhibition space. Here is the second section of the exhibition space. This is one of the seminar rooms, and you can also see the drum hall. And right next to it is the second seminar room, which is right next to the green roof. And this is mainly my glue model. Thank you very much for watching.